For the third year and counting, Richard Skipper has been celebrating the artists you love.
And what are some of the things that you've really...
We've run out of time, and we've got to talk about your latest... I want to go back a little bit, first of all, and celebrate a true legend.
Richard Skipper is all about celebrating life, art, and his guest body of work.
And did you pursue performing opportunities while you were in high school?
Please join us while he showcases these diverse and talented individuals. Here's Richard Skipper.
Happy Sunday, everyone, and welcome to a very special edition of Richard Skipper Celebrates. Who or what are you celebrating tonight? I, of course, am celebrating Doris Day. I am such a huge fan of Doris Day. Let me just prove it to you. Considering Doris Day. Doris Day by Eric Braun. Doris Day, Her Own Story. Doris Day by David Kaufman. Doris Day, An Illustrated Biography. And of course, was that a name I dropped? This happens to be one of my favorites. I'm not saying that simply because Paul Brogan, who wrote it, is on the show tonight. But tonight, we're going to be celebrating Doris Day. Today marks 100 years since she's been on this planet. And she's still with us. I'm often reminded of what Tyne Daly said when Carol Channing passed away. She said, think of her as being in the next room. And she is in the next room. Right now, if you turn on Turner Classic Movies, but don't do it until after this show is over, you can go to Turner Classic Movies and she is there. She's trending on Twitter right now. She is everywhere. She's on the radio station. I've been going around the dial today. Yes, you can still go around the dial. And she is there. She is everywhere. She is still very much a part of our consciousness. Doris Day, from the moment that she hit the airwaves in 1939, she's been a part of our lives. And tonight, I'm going to celebrate her with a few friends. We're celebrating her legacy, her life. We're not here to mourn her. We're here to celebrate her. And I've put together a little montage. It's spring. It's Doris Day. We're going to show a few photographs of her, just something that we've put together, and I hope you enjoy it. And then Paul and I will talk on the other side. Here she is, Doris Day.
Hey, buds below, up is where to grow. Up with which below can't compare with. Hurry, it's so lovely up here. Come, rhododendron, courage, little friend. Everything will end, rhododendron. Hurry, it's lovely. A feed. Bloom buttercup, buds are better up, where in case of nuptials you're handy. Hurry, it's lovely up here. R-S-V-P-P and E's pollinate the breeze, make the queen of bees hot as brandy. Come give at least a preview of Vista. Life can be rosy if you're a posy.
Doherty. Was that a name I dropped?
What a great montage. Wonderful.
Well, my husband Danny put that together this afternoon. I picked the pictures because it just, there's such love in that face. How can you not love her? And you knew her as a friend, a confidant. How, you know, it's in your book, and we're going to give away a copy of your book tonight. Your only copy left, I might add. And you just sold it, a copy, for a very hefty price on eBay.
Well, actually, it was somebody else's that they sold it on eBay for $1,200.
And yes, it's a nice price there. But you talk about this in the book. For those who don't have the book, let's talk about, first of all, what is it about Doris Day that gravitates towards you or brought you in at such an early age in your life?
She just seemed, she didn't seem to be actressy. She seemed natural and real and exactly like a person you would meet would be. There was nothing phony. She exuded a certain genuine quality that just brought you into her. And the fact that she was playing a mother in the film, Please Don't Eat the Daisies, made, you know, a little boy in elementary school wish that if I didn't have my own mother, I'd love to have her for a mother.
And you wrote a letter telling her so. Am I correct?
Yes, I did. Yes, I did. And in my beautiful scrawl, you know, printed. The whole thing was printed. But yes.
And you actually got a response.
I did. It went to Doris Day, Hollywood, California, in those days before zip codes. And it somehow made it to the studio. And somebody brought it to her attention, whoever was her secretary at the time. I guess that, oh, look at what this cute little boy in New Hampshire sent you. And she responded to it.
And you did meet her. And you also met her along with another secretary, who I might add is watching this show right now. She is welcome. She's got the link to come on if she wants to join us here, but she's had a very busy day herself. So tell us about that first time that you met Doris Day.
All right. Well, I had let Doris know, and Mary Ann, her secretary, know.
Hello, Mary Ann.
Yeah, to California in June of 1973, and that I would be there for a week and that I'd love to get together. And I heard back, we want to meet you. Absolutely. Please come to the house. That's simple. Just, you know, and I knew, of course, the address because I'd been writing to it. So on a Monday morning, I went over to the house and rang the buzzer. There was a gate outside the house. And very unpretentious home. A voice over the speaker said, hello. And I knew it was her, Doris, but I didn't want to gush. So I said, how do you do? This is Paul Brogan. I'm here to see Miss Day. And her response was, Paul, it's me, Dodo. Let me open the gate. Come on in. And so the gate swung open. It was like Dorothy arriving in Oz. And I walked up the driveway toward the door. The door opened, and there was Doris standing there. And, hello, so good to meet you, finally. And she walked over to me and hugged me, and that was it.
And there was absolutely no pretense there. There was none. I mean, it was not as if you were meeting a movie star.
Yes.
You truly were meeting the mother in Please Don't Eat the Daisies.
Exactly. And she invited me right into her home. I mean, nowadays, there would certainly be fears and concerns about what a star was inviting into their home. But no, brought me right in. Mary Ann was there. We sat in the living room looking out toward the pool and chatted before we went off to Nate and Al's to have a bite of breakfast.
Well, you know, I've been very, very fortunate, and I thank God for how lucky I am, and I don't take it lightly. The celebrity friends that I've made over the years. You and I both had a mutual acquaintance in Carol Channing. And you can meet celebrities, and I've been to their homes, and it may be that passing fancy, or you meet one time and then you never see each other again.
Right.
That wasn't the case. No. You and Doris became friends. Mm-hmm. What was it about the two of you that you feel solidified the friendship with the two of you? What was that bond beyond fanship, let's go there, that the two of you had?
I think she saw in me someone who wasn't a star chaser necessarily. I did write about, I guess, I told her I'd seen With Six You Get Egg Roll 54 times. And she looked at me and said, "You didn't get diabetes?" And that was the last time I brought up one of her film roles or talking about anything like that. We talked a lot about the animals. We talked about work ethic without her specifically talking about being on the movie sets and those things, but about the importance of honoring a deal and honoring your word and everything else. And I think she knew. Terry Melcher, her son, said to me in a letter years later, "You're one of the few of Mom's fans who became a friend that wasn't on the tape." I think that.
Well, I'm glad you brought up the animals, because and everybody who's watching tonight, we are doing this tonight to celebrate not only Doris Day, but to raise money, if we can, for the Doris Day Animal Foundation. So everyone who's watching, if you can make a donation of any amount, make it directly, not to me, but to the Doris Day Animal Foundation. They are aware of the show tonight. Thank you. They've been tweeting about this today and sharing this, which I appreciate. Please make a contribution of any amount if you can, because Doris Day, she worked tirelessly for the animals up until the very end. And let's face it, our animals are our best friends. They're there for us. Yours is out right now for his eating walk. Mine is having his dinner. So it's very, very important. But tonight we're also going to celebrate her fans. I have a couple of fans that are waiting in the wings. And I'm going to also bring on another fan in just a moment. But before I bring him on, he also had the pleasure of meeting Doris Day just a couple of years ago. And we're going to talk about his experience of meeting Doris. But he sent me a clip a couple of days ago, this incredible montage, and I debated on whether or not I would share this tonight. I am going to share it. It's from a YouTube channel. If the person whose website I took it from sees this, I hope you will appreciate the fact that I'm sharing this because of its brilliance and not because I'm stealing it. I applaud you, and I wanted to celebrate what the brilliance of what you put together. So this is another celebration of Doris Day, and I will bring on another fan in just a few moments. Here it is, celebrating 100 years of Doris Day.
Us. We didn't come prepared. But we do have Doris Day. How would you like to hear her do a number?
Everybody loves a lover.
Everybody loves a lover. I'm a lover. Everybody loves me. Anyhow, that's how I feel. Wow, I feel just like a Pollyanna. I should worry, not for nothing. Everybody loves me. Yes, they do. And I love everybody.
thinking it's no one else but me. Gee, I feel just about 10 feet tall. Having a ball, guess you might call me Pollyanna. Everybody loves a lover. Person loves a lover. I can't help thinking it's no one else.
Everybody loves me.
Gee, I feel just about 10 feet tall.
I feel
having a ball.
I feel
well. I feel just like Pollyanna. I should worry not for nothing. Everybody loves me. Yes, they do.
Thank you very much.
So whoever put that together, you are brilliant, and I want you to come on my team. Now, isn't, I mean, who could not love her?
I don't think it's possible.
And shame on you, Brian, sitting in the sunshine there. And Brian, for everybody. So, Brian, are you sitting in an orange grove or?
I am not. I'm sitting at your friend's house, at Anastasia's house, and I'm taking care of her little kitties. And I'm actually leaving shortly, but I'm here in Los Angeles, and I wish I could show you the. It's ridiculous. I'm lucky. So, it's beautiful here. So, there are actually orange trees and lemon trees right here, but I'd have to take you on a little video tour.
Well, God bless you. Thank you for, you know, for taking the time to be here this evening. But I want to talk to you about the fact that you you got the chance to meet Doris Day. Before we get there, a few years ago, again, my husband and I, we were on vacation and we went to Carmel, California, which, of course, Carmel, Doris Day, they are inseparable. You can't think of one without the other. But when we went there, I said, I have to stay at the Cypress Inn. And we went with, we had a Yorkie at the time named Chip. And the wonderful thing about staying at the Cypress Inn is when you checked in, they had a list of all of the pet-friendly hotels in Carmel. And if you decided to go to a restaurant that was not pet-friendly, because there were a couple, they had pet sitters in the hotel that would come and sit with your pet because she did not want you to leave your pet alone in the hotel. But we took him with us and we had a wonderful time. Thank God that you were allowed to do that. And of course, there were posters everywhere. And I had this incredible dream that at any moment I was going to turn around and Doris Day was going to be there. And of course, as you know, Brian, her music is wafting throughout the hotel everywhere. So you go to Carmel, you do meet her.
Well, and I didn't get to meet her. I did see her in person, but I didn't get to meet her. It's not like we got introduced and talked. But I'd gone to Carmel a few years before that and stayed at the hotel. And a friend of mine took me and I was not ready for my reaction, but I knew I was thrilled to be there. I was not ready to start blubbering like a baby in the hallway when I heard Nonstop Doris. I was a gigantic nerd, and I just, my back against the wall, and I just start sobbing. I'm sure people are like, all right, he's scary, but this is how I feel about her. This is what evokes in a lot of people. Then in 2014, I think, maybe wonderful Scott Dreyer, who does a wonderful show about
Scott
Doris.
Dreyer, we love you.
Love Scott Dreyer. And it is because of him, because we were having dinner and he said, Brian, do you know about that we go every year and sing happy birthday to Doris? I was like, no, I didn't know that. He goes, that might be something you'd like to do. I was like, yes, it would be. And so he called when it was getting time for that next year. And he said, hey, it's going to happen. Do you think you're free? I was like, oh, I'm free. And I stayed at, you know, what is the, you all will know, the Quail Lodge. Mm-hmm. Quail Lodge. So I was just within walking distance of standing underneath her balcony. And she came out. I am telling you, and I tried to send you, but I couldn't, the file was so big, I couldn't send you. She came out and talked to us for, I would imagine, an hour or more. She would not leave until the last person had left. She cried. She was the most genuine. I cried. I cannot tell you, because I've been fortunate, like you all, I've been fortunate to meet Mae West. I've been fortunate to meet a lot of wonderful people in my life. Doris Day, I had thought, you know what? I'm just going to have to be lucky that I was here on the earth with her. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be okay. Who could ask for more? When I got this gift of going and seeing her in person, and she talked to all of us via the phone with her assistant down there, I cannot tell you I don't even have the words, how kind, how warm. She kept saying, I can't believe you're here. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I would take the time out of your day, but it means so much. And it was absolutely beautiful. I will tell you an embarrassing story about years when I was very young, a teenager, probably the same year I met Mae West. And my parents took me around in a car to see all the stars home. And of course I had to see Doris Day's home.
Mm.
Walked up to the front. This was in Beverly Hills. And I walked up to the front door and I knocked on the door like only a child from St. Louis would do, not having any class, that they would just knock on someone's door. And so many dogs, like that's what I remember. So many dogs barked, but nobody answered the door. So I was like, well, that's okay. I'll go. And I turned around to go, and there was an orange tree right there in the front. And I'm going to close this because it's an orange tree. So I thought to myself, again, I'm so embarrassed for this, but Maya Angelou says, when you know better, you do better.
Uh-huh.
I should take an orange. Embarrassing. But I reached up and I grabbed an orange. And just as I had it in my hand, as it came off, I heard, can I help you? So embarrassed. And I don't know if it was Mary Ann. I don't know who it was. And I put the orange behind my back as if they didn't see. I said, well, hi. I was wondering if Miss Day is home. And she said, no, I'm so sorry. She's not. She said, would you like me to have her send you an autographed photo? And I said, yes. And I gave her my address. And sure enough, we got back from vacation to St. Louis. And there was an autographed photo of Doris Day that said, warmly Doris Day. And later, when I became an actor, I would sign warmly Brian Norbury.
Ah, good for you.
Of Doris Day.
I want to ask both of you a question. I mean, obviously, we're all huge fans of hers. One of the things I think that as I read about her as time went on, I think it really amazed her. And there was a radio station over the years that she would come on the radio and fans would call in and she would talk to the fans on the radio. And she always seemed to be surprised that A, people still remembered her and that people still cared. Why do you think that she still was so surprised that people still loved her? And because we do, And we still, here we are on a Sunday night when we all could have been doing many other things. Here we are celebrating her, you know, and so many, there's such an outpouring of love for her today, everywhere. Why do you think that she did not drink it in as much as the rest of us do?
Yeah, you go ahead and start.
Oh, okay. I don't think she ever had a real awareness as to how good she was because she didn't have an ego. She didn't go to her films when they came out. She was doing her job. She always did the best she could, but she didn't look at it as being something that years from now people would gravitate to. But it's not false modesty that she wasn't a part of the Hollywood scene. She didn't like to go to the parties or any of those things. And she didn't surround herself by people who were sycophants and saying, oh, Doris, you're so wonderful. Her friends were the technicians that worked behind the scenes or people, you know, that were extras and people she'd known a long time. So she didn't need to have herself fed about how wonderful. And so when people would tell her how much she had meant to them, she was genuinely amazed. It wasn't an act she was putting on. She truly didn't understand the effect she had on people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Brian, do you have a take?
So true. She had so many important things in her life anyway. That truly affected her dog. Now her work affected her too, and she took it serious, obviously, but I don't think she did have any idea that I think she knew she entertained people. I think she knew that was, I'm sure, obvious, but I don't think she knew that she touched them so deeply, that she healed them. I think that confounded her. And I know Scotty Dreyer was able to tell her, and she was able to hear that one day, which really makes us all so happy. And she really took it in, which is great. I really, you know, I remember on the Tonight Show once when Rex Reed was telling her how much he loved her and appreciated her. And he said, you don't get it. And she said, I don't. She goes, it's lovely. I think it's wonderful, but I don't. And Johnny Carson's, or was it Rex? I can't remember who said, well, what would you change about, you know, what would you change about the movies you did? The scripts? And she thought they were light and fluffy. She didn't understand she didn't understand how, and I, you know, forgive me, I would go on forever, how unbelievably natural she was, how genuine she was. There was, just like Paul said earlier, there was absolutely no artifice. In a time when there was a lot of artifice in acting, she had none. And I remember that wonderful line that Tony Randall said about her crying in all the scenes in the car after he found out that Rock Hudson is Rex, you know, that he's Rex Stetson, or whoever, I can't think of the name now. But he said, take after take after take after take. Now, there's probably 10 takes in the movie. Now, each take probably took 12 takes for that. He said every single time, real tears. And he said she figured if she could do it, it must be easy. And he said, it's not that easy for the rest of us.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Wow.
Really, she was a method actress before people knew what a method actress was. It's that genuine. That's that genuine quality about her heart. And I don't know, her soul coming through.
Wow. Well, I want to say a gremlin got into here and the wrong banner just went across the screen. It's not the word to put in is hashtag grace. So everyone go back, put in hashtag grace to get Paul Brogan's book. I'm going to bring on our next guest in just a moment. But before we do that, I'm going to show another clip. And this is from one of her television specials. And this is going to show the purity of just how pure she was as a singer and as an actress. Another great singer and actress that I'm going to be celebrating at the end of this month, who also had a big hit with this song, But Doris Day owns this song. Here it is. And you'll all know what I'm talking about in a moment. Here she is.
Memories light the corners of my mind. Misty watercolored memories of the way we were. Scattered of the smiles we left behind, smiles we gave to one another for the way we were. Can it be that it was all? Or has time rewritten every line? If we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? Could we? Memories are too beautiful. What's too painful to remember? We simply choose to forget. So it's the laughter we will remember.
Mary Ann Kong is here. Hello, Mary Ann.
Hello, Richard. Thank you for having
Hello.
Me.
Someone is texting me, and hold on for 1 second because I think, sure. Hold on.
That's okay. I have to keep my composure.
Keep talking. hold on because I'm going to type her. Someone that has a very close relationship with Doris. Hold on. She might be able to join us. Keep talking. Mary Ann, talk about what Doris means to you while I'm typing for a second.
Oh, I grew up with Doris Day, and just what a gift that was. She and her memory is still so vivid to me. I saw today, Richard, that you were going to do film scores today as well.
Yes, and yes, and that's what I want to talk to you about.
I was thinking, what's my favorite Doris Day film score? And I'm torn between Love Me or Leave Me, because we get to hear 12 Doris Day solos. And then The Man Who Knew Too Much, where we get one song that just resonated forever and became such a signature piece of hers with Que Sera Sera. So I don't know. What do I love the most? 12 Doris Day songs? One great one? I can't make up my mind with film scores. It's just too much.
Well, today is National Film Score Day, and who would have thunk that a song like Que Sera Sera, written for an Alfred Hitchcock film, as essentially a, you know, to move the plot along a little bit, as a, if you'll pardon me for saying this, because I don't mean it in the way it's going to come across, as a throwaway, but it would become such an iconic song, and it would become her theme song. And I think she sings it in three of her films. Am I correct? Can you guess which films she sings it in?
Definitely, isn't it Please Don't Eat the Daisies?
Please Don't Eat the Daisies, definitely.
And the Glass Bottom Boat.
And the Glass Bottom Boat.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And it does have a bit of a throwaway. It's not that, is it the Hitchcock MacGuffin? I don't know if it's that, but it is, it's a device that's used. And when she belts it out, and when she did, she would do something with notes that was quite, she would get around the note somehow and almost flat sharp it. She had a distinctive do de sound. And when she belted that out for her son Hank to hear upstairs, we were all cheering at home. Every time I see the movie.
Excuse me for interrupting. Jackie Joseph just joined us. So Jackie, I just private messaged you the link. And if you can click on the link, we can bring you on camera if you're up to it. So I would love to bring you on. I absolutely love Jackie. Jackie Joseph, of course, was on the Doris Day. Well, she did, you know, she was in a couple of movies with Doris and was also in the TV series. And we have a plant in Danny's office that we call the Audrey 2 because, of course, she was in Little Shop of Horrors. And the plant is taken over the office.
I have a quick Jackie Joseph story.
Okay.
When I was serving on National Board for AFTRA and for Screen Actors Guild, Jackie at all the meetings would gather together all the amenities from the hotels and say to us, please put these together. I'm donating them to the homeless. She would always do that. And it's just endeared me to Jackie forever.
Well, I just absolutely love Jackie. I hope she can come on with us for a few moments. Jackie has been on the show before. And we just absolutely love her. But in celebration of film scores, Paul, do you have a favorite film score of Doris's? Whether it be, you know, a musical film score or a dramatic film score?
I'm partial to Midnight Lace because I think the score helps to set the tone so vividly. And it just all seems to meld together with the acting and the scenery and the great costumes by Irene, but the score just helps to drive the film. And it stays with you afterwards and sort of haunts you.
And what about you, Brian?
I would probably have to say Love Me or Leave Me. I mean, I just lose my mind at that. I mean, so many amazing songs. And one of the things I was thinking of, it's not a film score. One of my favorite albums is, what is the album with, y'all will know it. And I cannot think of his name right now, which is embarrassing. Just at the Piano. It's just she.
Andre Previn.
Andre Previn.
Yeah.
That, I lose my mind. I mean, it's just, so those are two of my biggies, but they're all perfect.
Absolutely. But her version of Little Girl Lost, Little Girl Blue from Jumbo is one of the most haunting. And the way it's filmed is so incredible. But, you know, she's so brilliant as a comedian. And the fact that she so seamlessly went from being a big band singer. If you know very much about her history, her dream was to be a dancer. And of course that got, you know, no pun intended, but she was in that horrible accident. Mm-hmm. And that changed the entire course and trajectory of her life. And she became a singer, something that she did not plan on. It was just one of those strange quirks of fate that changed the direction that she went in.
It is.
It would be so amazing. I mean, that's, I can't even imagine what they must have thought when you hadn't thought of singing, and then you have that voice.
Mm-hmm.
I can't even imagine what that must have been like. To, and I guess she, I don't know. I think she did, and you all knew her, so you would know. I think she did know that she was able to do things, not in a false way. She just knew she could do it. A part of that was her faith. Just, mm-hmm. But
Kay Ballard told a very funny story that they were having dinner one night in Carmel, and they went to a restaurant, and they were talking about Stephen Sondheim. I think that Sending the Clowns had just come out, and they were discussing the song, and Doris Day was talking about how haunting and beautiful she thought the song was. And they're sitting at this quiet table in the corner, and she started singing. And all of a sudden, the people around her were aware that Doris Day was singing at this table. And do you know this story, Paul?
Have you No, actually.
And then all of a sudden, there was like this hush around everyone. And, you know, and then Kay Ballard started looking around and she said, "You have an audience. People are watching." And I don't know if you all are aware of this, but she was offered a lot of money over the years to go to Vegas, to come to New York. She did not like performing in front of an audience.
No, she was paralyzed with, she did it for Your Hit Parade. When she was on Your Hit Parade was an audience. But when she did her CBS radio show, and she had guests come on and sang, there was no audience. It was canned applause at the end of the songs because her stipulation was that she would not do that. And it was the same with the two television specials that she did, that they were not to be done in front of a studio audience. Mm-hmm. She just had froze at the thought of performing. She had performed on the Academy Awards once. It's Magic. When it was nominated in 1948, she performed at the ceremony in 49. But none of the other songs, five more of her songs were nominated for Oscars during the following years. And in every instance, someone else performed it on the Oscar ceremony.
Well, you know, it's very interesting. I mean, Paul, you knew her later on after her film career was over. In your conversations with her, did she ever talk about, was there ever that tinge that she ever wanted to go back to performing ever?
She would always say, if the right thing comes along, I'll do it. And she even went so far as to sign a contract to do a TV series in 1990 that was going to be a group for ABC. But she had approval on the scripts and could back out. And she always said, the scripts aren't what I want them to be. So she just, but no, there were offers made. Turning Point for her and Audrey Hepburn in the parts played by Anne Bancroft and Shirley MacLaine and wow. other things. Albert Brooks went up there and they read the script to Mother together at her home in 1995 because he wanted her to play his mother. And she told him afterwards, no, I don't want to go back, but it was very nice to meet you. So there were opportunities and she was always very gracious about it, never said to somebody's face, no. But I don't think her heart was ever in going back again.
Well, she had, I mean, her love, of course, was her, I mean, her animals yeah. and mm-hmm. her activism.
Yes.
She, at the time that she decided to write her autobiography mm-hmm. and that she did God bless her. She did what anyone who writes an autobiography has to do. She did do the circuit, going on the Tonight Show and getting out there and plugging the book. And I remember, as tells you the kind of strange kid that I was, the excitement that I had of her being on the Tonight Show that night, because it was so rare for her to come out and do that kind of, you know, an appearance or something. But do you think that there was ever the possibility of her ever wanting to come back? Or do you think it was just, you know, no, I'm never going to really do it?
She never actually said, I'm retired, I'm never going to work again. She always left that door open, and the offers poured in. Murder, She Wrote. She was offered it before Angela Lansbury, the series. And it was even announced in the press that she was going to come back and do it for this huge amount of money. But she always said no at the last minute. And even Terry, her son, a few times tried to get her to move forward and do something, but ultimately, no. I think that once she got out of that kind of pressure cooker, and she was never someone who was ruthless. She was out of place in the industry. She didn't follow the box office grosses. She didn't read the reviews. None of that was important. She didn't know who was doing what to who in Hollywood. She would get on her bicycle and, you know, as though she were living in a small Midwestern town. And she just didn't have that passionate drive when there were other things that she would let fall into place. Very much whatever will be, will be. Whatever came along, she, you know, looked at it as something positive.
It's rah, rah. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mary Ann, when did you first become aware of Doris Day and the magic of what made Doris Day, Doris Day? You're an actress yourself. What is it about Doris Day that makes her so special with you?
I was first captured by her in the Rock Hudson movies. That's my age range growing up. Mm-hmm. And I just loved the playfulness that the two of them had. And I'm a character actress, surprise. And I'm always surprised when pretty people are funny. And she had that ability to really, really grab on to comedy. So that, and I probably didn't even realize it at the time that that captivated me. And then as I got older and I'd see work of that, forgive me, guys, you'll have to help me with this. The movie she did with Sinatra.
Young at Heart. Young at Heart.
God, oh my God. I can still see the windshield wiper going in the car.
Yes. Yes.
God, that and today, Love Me or Leave Me, the Turner hat on today. The depth of her work. I think she's just gotten, her work has gotten richer for me as I've gotten older and really can really see, again, the range, the depth. I'm dialing back to when you just played The Way We Were. I've never seen that song acted so beautifully. Mm-hmm.
But
You
know, I think that time is a great healer as well. And as we go, as we move on, do you think that as time goes on, that people, like now with Turner Classic Movies, they've always appreciated her. And we have always appreciated her. Do you think that as time goes on, that people will appreciate her as an actress more and more? I think that, you know, Oscar Levan had the famous quote, I knew her before she was a virgin. What was the quote?
I knew Doris Day before she was a virgin.
Something along those lines. But when you look at, if you go back and you look at Pillow Talk, the character that she plays, and Lover Come Back and everything, there's a lot of playfulness in that those movies, and a lot of innuendo, and a lot that they were pushing the boundaries as far as it was a Ross Hunter film, and they were going as far as they could go at that at the time that the film was made. You know, when I the first time that I saw a few years ago in its entirety on TCM, Pillow Talk. Pillow Talk is not a 1960s film. It was late 50s. It came out before 1960. And so you go back and you look at these films and this quality that she had in film that was, I don't think that she's was, while she was here, was as appreciated as I think she should have been.
People who did appreciate her, but I do think there was a whole backlash with the 60s coming in and whole new kind of thing, and they got upset when anything even seemed prim or establishment. And they took it was kind of a quick decision to just cast her aside because it was different. They felt it was more glossy than this real earthy. But when you go back and look, she was doing things so real that when you go back and look, she was doing actually real work in those films. And I think when people look at it now, they'll be like, wow, we didn't give it we should have.
Well, a few months ago, I interviewed Sandy Duncan. And Sandy Duncan, when she did Peter Pan, we're talking about the fact that she even commented on this, that when she played Peter Pan on Broadway, it was effortless. And she said that she had always been taught that it was you're as an actor or an actress. And Mary, you can weigh in on this. And you too, Brian, that you are supposed to make it look effortless. That's the goal. And Doris Day made it look effortless. And I think when you are that good at making it look effortless, those that are sitting in the theater who are making those decisions are not always looking at the genius of the actor or the actress. And the only time that Doris Day was ever nominated for an Academy Award was Pillow Talk. Out of all of her films.
Well, what is the saying? What's the saying? It takes a lot of work to look this natural.
Exactly. You
know, and I do think if you really do look natural, you're not thought of as serious. We have to, you know, see the work. You know, it's like Olivier. I can see him working. Oh, I'm good. I'll get flack for this. But you know,
is that Olivier calling you now?
Yeah. God, it's Vivian from the grave. No, it's not my phone. No.
Sorry. Yeah. It was me.
But Jackie's got a comment here. Jackie said that she really had trouble traveling. It was uncomfortable for her back. She had to refuse so many events that needed her presence. And thank you, Jackie, for sharing that. I am going to show another clip. This is from my friend Doug suggested this clip. This is from early in her career, her film career. And then we're going to come back for our final words about Doris. And I've enjoyed this, and I really appreciate you all being here. And we're going to give away Paul's book. So everyone hang in here for just a few more minutes for one more clip. And this is appropriate till we meet again to close with this. Don't go anywhere.
Is it all right if I walk him to the gate?
Certainly you can, darling. You go right ahead. Sometimes I don't understand you.
Well, what did you want me to do? Let my daughter become a camp follower?
George Wadsworth Winfield, you listen to me.
And I'll write you every day I'm gone.
And I'll knit you some socks. I can't knit, but I'll knit you some socks.
Well, if I get my shoes on over them, I'll wear them.
Oh, I know I'm supposed to be brave, William, but you're gonna be so far away.
Oh, come on. It's not as bad as all that. You know the song all the doughboys are singing. Smile a while. I kiss you fond adieu.
Sad adieu.
When the clouds roll by,
I'll come to you.
Then the skies will seem more blue. Down in Lover's Lane, my dearie, wedding bells will ring so merrily. Every tear will be a memory.
Wow. 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 And once again, the word for today is grace. What better? And we're going to give away right now. We're going to give away the book, and I'll show you how this works. And thank you all for being here. We'll see who's going to get the book. My hands are here, so you know I have nothing to do with it. Tasha. So Tasha Lombardi gets your book, and you'll autograph it for Tasha.
Yes.
So Tasha, just send me your address again, and we'll make sure that it gets to you. I'm going to take this off, and I just want to remind everybody once again, and I'm going to pull this back up here. If you can all please, 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 I beg of you on behalf of Doris and all of our animals. Danny, can you bring Benny in here, please? I want you all to meet Benny. So if you could all make a contribution to the Doris Day Animal Foundation on behalf of Doris Day and Benny, who you will see in just a moment. And Mary Ann, I want to thank you for showing up. And I hope that, Mary Ann, that you'll come and join me. And I'd love to have you on the show. Jackie, thank you. Thank you all for being here. And I know that I can speak for all of our wonderful guests on the show today. Hold on for 1 second here. I want you all to meet Benny. This is Benny. Likes to steal the show. Doris would love him. So this is Benny, and Benny wants you all to contribute to the Doris Day Animal Foundation. Benny, look into the camera. So anyway, please make a contribution if you can. It would mean so much to all of us. I always also, if this is your first time at Richard Skipper Celebrates, don't let it be your last. Please come back and visit me. Otherwise, I'd just be opening the refrigerator door and performing for myself each night. So please keep coming back. Consider subscribing to Richard Skipper Celebrates. Leave a comment on YouTube. Tell your friends about the show. Tomorrow, I'm going to be celebrating West Side Story, both versions. So come back and join me tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. And I also end every show by telling everyone to go out and do something nice for somebody else without expecting anything in return. Go to your Facebook friends list and reach out to the third name that pops up. 3 for the third day of April for Doris Day. Reach out to the third name and make a phone call. Not an email message, not a text message, not a private inbox message, but a phone call. That's what Doris would want as well. because as my dear friend Sean Moniker says, we're all in this together, but we're not in the same boat. And you never know what someone else is going through right now. But I always say, if you're going to go out in a boat, make sure you bring a skipper along. So I'm going to leave this room, and I'm going to give each of you a chance to have your final word about what Doris Day means to you. I'm going to start with you, Mary Ann, and then Brian, and then Paul, you will have the final word. And don't worry about how to end the show. As soon as you say goodbye, Paul, the final credits will roll. Thank you all for celebrating Doris Day with me tonight. And thank you for being here for the last hour. And now you can all go to Turner Classic Movies. They have Doris Day, but the only thing they don't have is me. Maybe next year they'll have me. I love you all. Thank you for being here. Mary Ann, it's all you.
Well, I'll close with paraphrasing from a song today from Love Me or Leave Me. You made us love you. Happy birthday, Doris. Happy 100.
And I will say, all I can really think to say is thank you. That's all I can say. I hope that everyone, if they don't know a lot of Doris's work, will go out and start watching it, and they will be as moved as we all are. So thank you, Doris Day, for being born and for healing us, not just entertaining us, but healing us. I don't know what power you had, but you had it. I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you, Doris, for your friendship, your love, and your inspiration. You made me want to be the best person I could be. And I hope in a small way, I have followed through on the belief that you had in me. God bless you and happy birthday, dear friend.